Hey guys, so we're here for our Azure Cert discussion. I'm here with Guy Hummel, who's our Azure and Google Cloud content lead, and with Thomas Mitchell, who's our Azure course author. Do you think if someone is already pretty technically inclined, whether they're a student or just working somewhat as a dev or kind of in like a lower level DevOps role, is that something they should start with, or they could kind of think about their skills, explore the other ones and see if they can kind of leapfrog kind of?
Yeah, it's debatable. AZ-900 actually came out after they already had some of the other ones. Mm-hmm. So it's not a prerequisite for any of them. It's, you know, if you're not sure, if you're just getting into Azure and you want to get your feet wet before you really go all the way, you could start with AZ-900. You don't have to. I'll say it is cheaper actually than the other ones. I think it's $99 or something US, and most of them are 165, I think. Yeah. It's a little bit cheaper. It's a shorter exam too. It's only an hour long, and quite a few of them are 3 hours long these days. So anyway, you don't necessarily have to take it though. It's a good one to take if you're not planning on going on to the more technical ones.
Exactly, in that order, but I'll just start at the beginning. So for the AZ-103, what would you say, who would you say is the intended audience for that?
Well, it's for administrators, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, if you're a sysadmin, you know, managing a Windows infrastructure, like I've been in infrastructure for 20 some years. So I'm like the target demo, someone who manages the infrastructure, who manages the Windows machines, who ensures stuff is running. That stuff is now, you know, as you move to the cloud, that's where you'll find a lot of the AZ-103 type stuff, where you're actually administering stuff, deploying VMs, doing all that fun infrastructure related stuff that you're now moving from on-prem into the cloud.
So for that exam, the AZ-400, what do you think, who do you think are good candidates for it?
Depends on whether they have an aspiration to be a DevOps person or they already are one, right? Because if you're already using, I don't know, let's say Jenkins and things like that, and you're doing DevOps yourself on your on-prem servers, there's still a lot that you need to know that's different with, because this is, the AZ-400 exam is very specific to Azure DevOps. So you need to have the DevOps foundation, and then you need to understand how Microsoft does it with Azure DevOps, right?
That's a good point.
Yeah. So if you already have that DevOps foundation, you still need to learn a lot to see how Microsoft does it, but it'll help a lot if you already have that foundation. If you don't have the foundation already and you would just like to get into DevOps, you don't have to have a development background. Like, you know, you don't have to have years and years of being a software developer, but you need to have some kind of background in software development to really understand what's going on with DevOps.
Can we talk about a little just bit about the background or who that can be more targeted to for these Azure Cloud, these people who are aspiring Azure Cloud architects? Sounds very broad, but how can we place that more in like a real world example?
I'll tell you what, I would actually be a really good example of that. I mean, growing up in IT, I started my career as an admin, and I kind of worked into design and you know, building Active Directory solutions, building out, you know, different IT solutions in the Microsoft space. So those who are in like the infrastructure spot, that's kind of the end game for someone who's in infrastructure. If you're building Exchange organizations, or you're building Active Directory forests, or you're doing migrations, all that stuff is infrastructure, and your progression is to an architect. I mean, there have been points throughout my career where that was actually my official title, as architect. So if you're like an engineer and you go into a senior engineer, then you're into an architecture role. Well, that's where you're architecting solutions. You're building solutions. And in an Azure specific world, you're building them in Azure, or maybe not even building them in Azure. You can be building them on-prem or some combination of both, but you're leveraging the Azure services and features that are available to build those solutions. So anyone who is in the infrastructure space, that would be like the end game.
There is the AZ500. So that's Microsoft Azure Security Technologies. Who would be a good candidate for that?
I've been told, my youngest is looking to maybe get into IT, and friends of mine who are in IT have said cybersecurity, that's the way to go. Anything security related. I mean, if you're more into the hacker stuff, I guess I'll say, that's probably a good path for you. I mean, not everybody wants to build solutions. You know, some people prefer to chase down the hackers and protect against the hackers and do all that fun cyber sleuthing stuff. If that's your game, then the AZ500 would be where you would head.
And so the AI100 is for, I guess you could, in a way you could consider that one an entry level exam for that area, because the AI services that Azure has, that are kind of the easy ones to implement in a way, are cognitive services, they're called. And this is where Microsoft has already built, they have these pre-built machine learning models that they know work really well in a particular area, like in object recognition in pictures, and like language translation and things like that. So they already have these pre-built models, and you can just access those models without having to know anything about machine learning, really.
Yeah.
So cognitive services is the core of that AI100 exam. You do need to know about some other, I was surprised actually at how many other Azure services you needed to know about in order to answer a lot of these questions. But really it's cognitive services. And so, you know, it's a very good one if you're getting started in that whole area of artificial intelligence. Those are actually on quite different topics. You need to know a lot about, let's say, relational databases and data analytics and various things like that. So it's just a completely different area, right? And so the numbers really don't mean anything. The other thing that's surprising to me about this is that in order to get your data engineer certification, you have to pass both DP200 and 201. And the only other place you see that in their whole certification suite is AZ300 and 301, which are the architect expert certification exams. And the data engineer ones are just at the associate level, right? I find that quite surprising. I think they should probably be an expert level, and that should be an expert level certification. They're set up in basically the same way. AZ300 is kind of the more practical side of the architect, where you actually have to know how to do some of the hands-on stuff. And 301 is where you need to know how to design solutions. You need to know kind of the theory behind everything. They do exactly the same thing with DP200 and 201. Mm-hmm. DP200 is kind of the more practical end of the data engineering, and 201 is the design developer. Yeah, it's the developer certification. And I think this is a very difficult exam, actually. they have code on almost every question on that exam. Right. So you can't fake this one. You need to know something. they'll give you blocks of code, and they'll have drop downs where you have to fill in the blanks, things like that. You know, what piece of code would you put in this spot here in this block of code? Things like that. Not all the questions are like that, but they all have some kind of, you know, code to them. Which is why they don't have hands-on labs, but it's also it makes it very difficult. You're not just answering basic questions about things.